explain to me, Don, the origins of this project and kind of give me, put it in terms of how projects begin in Disney Animation. How do they get off the ground?
Well, I suppose the genesis of every project comes from just the germ of an idea. And on Lion King, it was the idea of a coming-of-age kind of hero's journey story.
Hi, that's me, Don Hahn, back in 1994, the year we released The Lion King. And this is sort of a home movie of all the people and circumstances that made The Lion King happen. The idea came from Jeffrey Katzenberg, who was head of the studio, Peter Schneider, the VP of the studio at that time, and also the great Roy Disney. And it happened during this conversation while they were out promoting Oliver and Company in Europe.
I was on a plane with Jeffrey, and somehow the topic of Africa came up. And Jeffrey said, that's what we should do. We should do a movie about Africa.
The kernel of that idea is something that actually originated with me and was reflective of something that happened to me earlier in my life.
Jeffrey didn't start out in the movie business. He was in politics in New York, and I think it was kind of a bumpy road for him. He had a couple curveballs thrown his way, and in a sense, a lot of his experiences became the inspiration for the story of The Lion King.
So I actually always felt the connection to the film because, in a way, it is a little bit about myself.
Sorry.
It's about, first of all, knowing who you are, you personally, inside of yourself, and learning to be true to that, and learning not to absolve yourself from your own responsibilities.
There are a bunch of early writers in the film. Linda Wolverton, who wrote Beauty and the Beast, was one of them. And all of the development was being directed by George Scribner, who had just come off a big hit with Oliver and Company.
Check it out!
And they called it King of the Jungle.
There was a lot that we had decided pretty early on. I knew I wanted to push it more, for lack of a better way to put it, more naturalistic.
George was paired up with a second director, Roger Allers, and Roger had done a brilliant job as the head of story on Beauty and the Beast.
The screening of Beauty and the Beast and the Rap Party was the night before the morning when we all got on the plane to fly off to Kenya to do research for Lion King. So it was kind of an ecstatic time.
Six of us went for 2 weeks. It was myself and Roger as the directors, Chris Sanders and Lisa Keene as the art directors, Brenda Chapman as head of story, and then one administrative adult who was supposed to watch over us.
I was one of the very fortunate people that was allowed to go on that Africa trip and was completely unprepared for what I was going to find there.
Maybe it's because all of humanity came out of Africa and we're like all tapping back into the motherland or something. But all of us had such an intense relationship to the land. Watching the whole play of life and death, and it's so moving. Ugh. Our guides would tell us Swahili phrases, and that's where we learned Hakuna Matata, which wound up getting into the movie.
There was this incredible other level to the whole thing where we just brought a little piece of Africa back inside of us. And I remember we had these very intense discussions and said, how can we get this on screen? How can we get our audience to feel a little tiny bit of what we felt when we were there?
That movie would just not have been the same without that trip.
So when the field trip was over and everybody got back to Burbank, we were really anxious to get going on the story.
George was passionate that he would like to do a movie that would had more of a kind of a National Geographic kind of sense, you know? He really wanted to do the nature red in tooth and claw kind of movie. And I get that. It's just, it isn't me. And so when we were paired up, as much as we like each other personally, it was really hard because it felt like we were constantly compromising to land somewhere between the kind of movie he'd like to do and the kind of movie I'd like to do. One thing we agreed on, we loved African music and modern African music.
Tim Rice was already at the studio writing for Aladdin with Alan Menken, and he was involved in The Lion King from the very early stages, and we were looking for a songwriter to team with him, a musician to team with him.
Well, when the whole thing started, they in fact said to me, who would you like to write the music? And Alan Menken is working already on Aladdin and is very busy, so who would you like? And I said, well, Elton John, but you won't get him. I said, you haven't a hope, he'll be too busy. And to my amazement, they said, well, we'll ring him up. After long and difficult negotiations, of which I was no part, Elton did it, and it was fantastic.
It seems obvious now that Elton wrote the music for The Lion King, but back then it was a real head-scratcher for a lot of people.
I don't understand why Elton, why we're trying to make a movie from Africa. What does this have to, I'm clueless.
George, I think, pretty much expressed his disappointment in Elton's music, and I think that maybe didn't go over too well.
Okay, hard cut. About a month later, it's time for you to go away. Thank you very much. We're going to go in a different direction.
It was like a Sunday night, and George called me and said that he'd been taken off the movie. And it was like, what?
You know, I had a lot of learning to do. I totally understand where that decision came from. It's a business. You do what you think is correct, and you move on.
When Lion King came up as an opportunity, I got called into Tom Schumacher's office, and he goes, things are changing. Are you willing to come and be the director with Roger Allers on Lion King? And I said, let me think. Yes. So the first day I remember coming in, having read the script, and there was about 20 minutes of story reel done. And I said, so what's the deal? How much of this movie do we need to keep? And you said, none of it. I said, like, wow, okay, so we're starting from scratch, which was terrific.
While the story was under construction, we had to get the animators up to speed. So there was this guy named Jim Fowler, who was a big star on a nature show called Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom. I think it was on Sunday nights with the Walt Disney Show. So we called up Jim, and he brought into the studio these huge cats. It was like Africa in Burbank. And it was really, I think, revolutionary for the animators, because now, all of a sudden, instead of drawing this abstract, they could actually sit down in front of these cats and feel the size and the heat and the power of these animals. And that made a huge difference.
A lot of this behavior that you're seeing is perfectly natural. Grabbing that chain is just like grabbing the shin bone of a carcass, you know, and working with it. They'll do the same thing with a stick.
He brought in these cats, and you would see them do something, and he would point it out so you would understand the dynamic between these animals.
When this little cat saw the big one, I noticed that the first thing he did was put his ears back, which is a fascinating behavior, yeah. That's a great face on that cat. That's one of the nicest lions I've seen, yeah.
We all want Jeffrey to go up and say hi to the lion.
How close can
we? We'd love that. We'd love to have Jeffrey come up, yeah.
Jeffrey Katzenberg, Jim Fowler.
Jeffrey, I'll teach you.
First of all,
first of all,
tasty. European blood.
The first thing
we've been working on it for a couple of months, and then Jeffrey calls a breakfast meeting. And in the meeting, we have the whole crew from Pocahontas and Lion King. And Jeffrey says, Pocahontas is a home run. It's West Side Story. It's Romeo and Juliet with American Indians. It's a hit. Lion King, on the other hand, is kind of an experiment. We don't really know if anybody's going to really want to see it.
Jeffrey took us all to the Garden Terrace and told us if the movie did more than $50 million, he'd get on his hands and knees. No one had any faith in that movie.
Everybody ran as fast as they could toward Pocahontas. And I didn't want to work on Pocahontas because of my love of Jungle Book. But I really want to do something with animals. And here's my chance.
One of the first and I think most important ideas that we came up with at the time we were restructuring the story was to have the ghost of Mufasa come back to Simba and tell him that even though he might have died, that he hasn't left him completely.
Simba, you have forgotten who you are, and so have forgotten me.
So now with the new directors in place, the story was starting to come together. And we had this amazing team of storyboard artists who were the guys and girls who board out the movie and sketch it in almost comic strip fashion so you can get a visual idea of what the movie looks like. And one of those people was Chris Sanders, who was assigned the Mufasa's ghost sequence.
I had boarded it once before, speaking of the storyboard process, and I had pitched it. And I remember Roger said, I just don't feel it. I don't really get it. I don't understand why this would make Simba go back. And I really struggled.
But one thing you find out early is animation isn't a 9-to-5 job. I mean, when Chris was working on Mufasa's ghost, he would stay sometimes till 2 or 3 in the morning trying to figure out what that scene was going to look like.
I was having so much trouble getting down on paper, and I remember it was around 3 in the morning. I got up and I went all the way across the studio, and Brenda was the only person that was there.
See? He lives in you.
And I pitched it to her, and I remember she said that she thought it worked, and I was so proud of that. And I couldn't wait for the next day because I know that, you know, Roger was going to see it again, and I re-pitched it, and there it was. Like, I found that little piece of the movie.
I remember seeing storyboards in the hall. It was Chris Sanders' board of Mufasa's ghost. And I was just looking panel after panel after panel, and the words were so powerful. And then I saw it in a screening and what it sounded like with James Earl Jones' voice, and I was completely sold. I said, this is not a B movie anymore. This is an A+.
When you're casting a film, I think the directors really look for voice actors that can give you really unique performances without the benefit of their physical persona there.
Oh dear, I've said too much.
So when you go to someone like James Earl Jones, who does Mufasa in the story.
Look inside yourself, Simba.
His voice is so commanding that when he says anything, when he says, "Can I have a tissue, please?" everyone sits up and takes notice.
That's very good.
Nathan Lane and Ernie Sabella. Nathan came in and tried out for Zazu, and Ernie came out to try it for Hyenas, and when they saw each other at the session, they went, oh, wait a minute, give us a minute, and they came back, they went back out, came back in, and tried out together for the Hyenas. And I was there listening to them do their takes, and I was just laughing so hard, like tears were rolling down my cheeks. But that was for Hyenas.
Right, it wasn't until we got it back to California that we finally were looking for Pumbaa and Timon as characters. Finally, we plopped the tape in from the Hyena audition and thought, geez, these guys work so well together. Let's use them as Pumbaa and Timon.
They were perfect.
Hello! The shame!
Oh, he was a shame!
I tried changing my name!
Once in a name!
And I felt down hearted!
How did you feel?
Every time that I...
Hey, Pumbaa! Not in front of the kids.
Sorry.
This is where animation starts to feel like a three-ring circus, because at the same time we were recording voices in Los Angeles, Elton and Tim are off in a studio in London writing songs. And I remember one of the first songs they wrote, they called the Cheese Sandwich Song, and it's because Elton wrote it during lunchtime when everybody went out and made cheese sandwiches. And that song became this major anthem in the movie.
A Circle of Life was written on an afternoon up in Oxford Street. Because that was, for me, that was an extraordinary experience, because I think I rang Elton on the Monday, because we had the session on the Thursday, and said, look, I think I can get the lyric to you by Monday afternoon. Give you 3 days. And he said, no, bring it along on Thursday. I was actually lying. I hadn't quite finished the lyric. So I finished the lyric on Thursday morning and went into the studio and just watched Elton write what I think is one of his best tunes.
Well, two things happened around that time. We renamed the movie The Lion King, because King of the Jungle didn't make sense. There was no jungle. And then the score composer, Hans Zimmer, showed up with his toolkit and started to work magic on Elton's songs. And that really became kind of a 1-2 punch for our music team, because on one hand you had Elton and Tim and their great songs and sense of melody. And then we had Hans and his African vocals and percussion. And you put those together and it gave us a truly, truly amazing score.
What he's done with my stuff has been brilliant. It was his idea to put the African feel in Circle of Life. And it's really made a difference to the song and the opening of the movie. It fits in beautifully.
The opening song, Circle of Life, I just went crazy with it. I just went for it, put those choirs on, had my friend Levo do the African chant at the beginning.
Levo was parking cars for some valet service in Los Angeles, believe it or not, and Hans Zimmer had known him from an earlier film they worked on called The Power of One. And Hans asked him to do this opening chant for the movie. So he came into the studio one night, and the guys explained to him what the movie was about.
And we said, well, it's the story about a lion, and all the animals are coming to pay homage to the lion. And so he walked away, and about 15 minutes later said, okay, I think I've got something. And then they stood up at the mic, and they started singing the opening of the movie. And it was electrifying.
So you're working on a movie for a year or two, and you have to realize animated movies come together in kind of a mosaic fashion, bit by bit. And then one day you start to look at the sequences and continuity, and you go, wow, this is getting done, because you'll have a little pencil test, and then there might be some story sketch, and then some final color, and you actually get a sense of how the movie's working.
Oh, goody.
So we took the movie down to Atlanta, where Elton John was living at the time, and we previewed it to a real audience, and Elton snuck in the back of the theater, and we all watched together. And about halfway through the movie, I realized, you know, we forgot to tell him that we completely changed the love ballad.
Elton had written Can You Feel the Love Tonight as kind of a straight-up Disney love song, and we were all, you know, trying to be different. And so we said, let's have Timon and Pumbaa sing as a kind of send-up.
Oh, can you feel the love tonight? All the signs are there.
When the movie ended and we turned around and very quietly and with great control, he said, I think you've ruined the movie.
I remember as though it was yesterday. I was driving. I had gotten to San Francisco Airport. And as I was going across the Golden Gate Bridge, I had Elton on the phone screaming at me, said to me, you don't know what you're doing. This song is brilliant.
To his credit, I think, and this was really touching, I remember at the time, he said he had always been a Disney fan. He had in all the Disney movies, he always loved the love songs. This is why he agreed to do it, so that he could have a chance to write an iconic love song for a Disney movie. It was like, it was all coming from the right places in him.
And he was right.
That is probably the signature song for, you know, the biggest animated movie in history.
The good thing is that when you're in a creative environment, you're allowed to make mistakes. You're allowed to experiment, you're allowed to try something, and if it doesn't work, it's no shame on anybody. It's actually the death of creativity is when you don't do that. So, you know, I mean, it was okay that we tried and failed.
So we left Atlanta, which was, how do you say, disastrous, and we flew home, and I remember getting into bed about 2 o'clock in the morning and thinking, I am so glad that is over because nothing could possibly be worse. And then the room started to shake.
It is nighttime in a shaken Los Angeles basin where a deadly pre-dawn earthquake has given way to major aftershocks, a rising toll in casualties and damage. Tens of thousands of residents are still without electricity, water. Federal, state, and local officials all declared states of emergency.
So there we were, within months of finishing this movie, and all of a sudden, people can't get to the studio. I mean, the freeway bridges were out, and the studio's closed. There were gas leaks, and we started to figure out, if we're going to get this done, the deadline's not going to move. And so we started shuttling things back and forth. And all of a sudden, this next big film from Walt Disney Pictures, it's being done in garages around Southern California.
When we finally were able to get back into the studio, people were like camping out because they had no home. People were without power or water. It was crazy. It was like a tent town.
The last month of the movie was like a whirlwind, and the score was coming in at the same time animation was coming in. There was color, the finishing touches, the sound effects were coming together. And at the same time, Lebo actually went back to South Africa to vote for the first time. Apartheid had fallen, and Nelson Mandela was elected, and it seemed like Africa was in the air. And yet we couldn't help but wonder, does anybody really want to see a movie about a lion cub that gets framed for murder? But it was too late for that. It was showtime.
Roll 'em!
It is now 22 minutes before the hour. I'm over 50 years old, and every time Disney comes out with a new animated movie, I rush off to see it. And all this week, we're going to be looking at the magic that has created the new Disney animated feature. It is called The Lion King. And for the last 3 years, the studio has kept its pencils and brushes working hard, making him roar. If you like The Little Mermaid, Beauty and the Beast, and Aladdin, well, you ain't seen nothing yet.
You start with ideas. It's all about ideas, funny ideas, interesting ideas, emotional ideas. And I think that journey of an idea from something that happened over a cold pizza to something that happens out on screens everywhere around the world is truly extraordinary and something that is pretty unique to Disney.
The Evening Star was to go work at Disney and make pictures that sang and move people and made people laugh. And when you're in it, you're just trying to do the best you can. It's hard. It's really hard. Everyone's working really hard and you're working long hours, but people are laughing. And I always felt like there was such spirit. And then we wound up making these movies, which are just so beautiful. It was such a rich experience, a rich time. I love all those people. It's an amazing kinship, I think, we all have.
Everyone was so kind, and everybody was so alive. And you'd go into work, and you met these personalities, and you got to spend time with them. You didn't mind being at work. It really was a family.
I love it here.
And that family was making something so amazing, and they protected this thing, and they nurtured it, and it was what it was because of the people that worked on it.
It was so playful.
The circle of life.
I had no idea that you could have that much fun and it would be called work. Coming to work was never work.
Whenever I sat in the theater and that Disney logo would come up, I remember how proud I was of the thing I had been a part of.
I just feel so lucky. I'm the luckiest guy on earth. I can't believe it. Wouldn't trade it for anything. It's magic.
450,000 boxes of donuts in the making of this movie. Only 3 napkins, however, were used, which is a little bit of a commentary on animators.